Gordon Hayden.
Then we love movies. We're going to talk to an up-and-coming filmmaker who has a brand new film out, which has been garnering an awful lot of attention online. It's an Irish horror movie. It's called In a Stranger's House. The writer, director and star of the film is Richard Waters, and he's going to talk a little bit to us about the film's plot in just a sec and how he's managed to get it out there and distribute it. But before we speak to him, here's the little bit from the film.
Hello. Okay, so this is a weird one. I was looking at the footage from last night from when I fell asleep, just kind of going through it, and I came across the weirdest f***ing thing. I'm going to upload it, but doesn't if you can see this, see if you can see this on the screen. I have it queued up here. So I was just lying there, I was asleep, so I was sound asleep, TV was on. It is weird. Like, that's not the TV channel. It is just weird.
So there is a little section from In a Stranger's House, a new Irish found footage flick, which has been garnering a lot of praise online. And the film's writer, director and star and cinematographer as well, because it is a found footage film, is Richard Waters, and he joins me now. So we just play a little bit there, Richard, from the film, which sounds quite ominous and it got quite a foreboding feel to it there. So tell us about this found footage film in terms of its plot before we talk about the making of.
So In a Stranger's House follows a vlogger who answers an ad to house at a house in the middle of nowhere. And while he's alone in this house sitting, a lot of strange things start to happen. And through his vlog, he kind of chronicles it. He's sharing it with his followers. He's trying to get to the meat of what's happening. But obviously, things are escalating and escalating and getting creepier and creepier as it goes on.
We've seen a lot of found footage films at the moment, Richard. Like, we're going to have to look at the reemergence of them with the likes of Paranormal Activity all those years ago. So why, for you, did you think, OK, I'm going to go down this particular road, even though it has been done quite a lot over the last few years?
Well, I mean, for me, the film, it kind of came from a lot of angles. I mean, the very first angle has to be the fact that it is so cost-effective to do. I mean, it was just me for the most... In fact, the entire thing, apart from the odd person here and there, was just me. But that kind of ties into the bigger part of the story, is my last film before this was a film that had quite a big ensemble cast, a lot of actors on locations, and had a lot of angles, whatever, 3 weeks shooting it. Whereas this one became the antithesis of that, where it was, it's just me by myself, shooting this quite quickly over a couple of days. It started off as an experiment just to see if one certain idea I had would work, and then I ended up being so happy with how that execution came off, I decided to follow through with it and go for the entire thing. But found footage in general for me, though, I think a lot of people kind of malign the genre unfairly. A lot of people look at it as a kind of cheap way of making a bad film. I don't think of that at all. I think it's a device to make a film. Like, I think you look at things like Blair Witch or Paranormal Activity, I think you see very good, very effective films. There's plenty of bad films out there, but I think the worst kind of found footage films are films that might be better served as being a normal narrative film that shoehorn into the found footage genre, whereas ones that maybe embrace it, things like Creep, or Willow Creek, these ones, I think, embrace what found footage is, try and be a bit more realistic, and I think that's kind of the heart of the genre.
So Richard, for anyone that hasn't seen In a Stranger's House, and we will tell them where they can watch it online at the moment, but just tell us about creating some of the scares in the movie, like some of the set pieces, because you've got one, for example, where you're on the couch and then the TV just starts playing. You're fast asleep, but you still have your camera rolling, like, because it's there like a CCTV camera, just capturing everything during the night. And then we also have another creepy little scenario where this doll just keeps moving around the house, just keeps going back to a place where it shouldn't be, clearly signifying that there is something in this house moving that doll around. And then your use of sound, because at times it comes across like there's other people in the house. So again, we've got a lot going on there, but just trying to craft the scares, was that a difficult thing to do, bearing in mind you've got such a small budget?
Well, I've always, I'm a massive horror fan, and I was basically just trying to make a film as sincerely as I could. So what I was putting into this was what I thought when I'd watch a film like this would scare me, or would make me jump, or put me on edge. I mean, I've seen a few films where maybe they try and force a jump scare in. I wasn't kind of keen on anything like that. So things like the TV flickering and all that, I mean, that's kind of my little, loving homage to things like maybe Poltergeist, which is what I guess you could probably say for the doll as well. But even a bigger factor in that is I was making the film based on the things that were in the house around me. So the dolls, I mean, they're something I've grew. That house is my family home, and those dolls are something that have been in the house ever since I can remember. And I mean, I don't understand why people have these weird, creepy dolls. So, you know, I mean, what am I going to do but logically jump to the point that there's something weird going on with them? I wanted to make a film that people could follow and watch in a very simple way, but at the same time rewards a viewer who keeps an eye out. There's a lot of little hidden things, and I think that's for me is I love a film that has a lot of subtle cues that might be kind of easy to miss on the first look, like certain shadows that are might be moving around a place that you mightn't notice, or certain sounds that you mightn't pick up the first time round. Something that rewards a viewer really, and you know, the reward for that is hopefully a more intense and more scary experience.
Well, nice one, Richard, because I think for anyone listening in who is interested in making a horror movie or a film in general, that you can still breathe life back into the found footage genre. Now, talk to me about getting the film out there for an audience, because you followed up your film O'Brien's, which was this rom-com, Irish rom-com, which got a really strong release, especially on DVD. I remember going to big supermarkets that sell a lot of DVDs and you would see it there on the shelves. So, but this time you've gone the digital route. So talk to me about getting it out there for people to see.
So again, like, the O'Brien's was kind of a bigger beast in a lot of ways. There was a lot of people behind that, and like, I mean, I'm very proud of what we did with that film, but throughout the time from that, I mean, we did that and we shot that in 2012, and it came out in, I think, 2013 or 2014, whereas this one I shot bulk of it in 2017 and I finished and put it out there in October 2018. And for me, it was just supposed to be a very different experience. Whereas the O'Brien's had a sort of a plan in terms of going to festivals and a plan of getting distribution, and it was on airlines and likes. This one, I decided to go because it was so small, because it was just me. I decided to almost surprise people with it. I mean, my close circle of friends obviously knew about the film, and some people who had helped out on it knew about it. But for the most part, no one knew about this film until October 31st, 2018, when the film went live online for sale, and which was probably the biggest mistake I probably made, is that no one knew about the film before it came out. So now, a lot of people are still seeing the trailer and going, oh, you've made a movie, I can't wait to see it. So if you ever see online, whenever I'm talking about it as my new film, because it seems to me like a lot of people don't even realize it's in existence yet. It was kind of low risk in a way that, you know, it was something I liked. If it didn't go well, at least I was going to be happy with it. And I'm very happy with the film. I've been getting a very good reaction from people, but that's what I've been building it on, is it's out there for sale. It's on its website. It's on Amazon. People are reacting to it. You know, you get user reviews on Amazon and IMDb and stuff like that. I'm getting a lot of tweets from people about it. You know, I'm not getting all positive reaction, but I'm getting a lot of positive reaction. And if people are enjoying it, or taking the time to say why they liked or didn't like it, I want to be able to interact with that.
So, Richard, for anyone listening in who would be intrigued to see how you followed the O'Brien's, and just for someone who has made it on a shoestring budget, we're going to find out now in a sec where they can watch it. Budget-wise, hit me up with how much it cost.
A grand total, including its IrishHorrorFilm.com URL, was €30.
30 quid. So there you go. You have no excuses. 30 quid it has cost Richard to make In a Stranger's House. Do you know what we'll do? Let's try and get people to watch it, because I would be intrigued now for a film that was made for 30 quid, what people think of it. So if they do want to watch In a Stranger's House, you mentioned Amazon. Where else can they watch it?
The easiest way to watch it is to go to irishhorrorfilm.com. You'll see it there. You can rent it or buy it. It'll be streaming right away. That's the easiest way to do it.
Great stuff, Richard. Well, there you go. There's your two ports of call. Amazon and irishhorrorfilm.com. Richard Waters, writer, director, star of In a Stranger's House, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks very much.
We love movies with Gordon Hayden.